Thank you. That's a wonderful singing this morning. I'm glad to see all y'all this morning. And that song is so true. All I have needed, thy hand hath provided. Isn't that so true? Would you join me in prayer, please? Our Father, we're just so fortunate to be here. We're truly blessed, and you have taken such good care of us, and just so appreciate that. You've seen us through trials and tribulations, just like the song says. And we just bow before you and worship you in adoration. You're a great and mighty God, worthy of worship, greatly to be praised. We just now come before you, and we ask for you to help us push everything out of our minds so that we can just do it totally on you this morning and worship you. Thank you for all the ones that are here this morning. It looks like we have a good attendance, and we just glorify your name because of that. And we just pray for, as we continue on in the service, as the choir sings, and as Brother Tom preaches, that we'll all just leave in rejoicing and praising you. In Christ's name we pray, amen. Well, there are a few announcements this morning. If you're not able to come because of transportation issues, you can call 359-4077, and the bus will be there to pick you up. I think it picks you up about 5 o'clock in the morning. No, I'm kidding. It'll pick you up on time. The service starts at 9:30, and so they'll pick you up in plenty of time to get you here on a timely basis. In just a minute, we'll stand and greet each other. But first, hopefully have received these deacon nominations and have one in your hand. Those will be collected at the end of the service. Is there anyone here who doesn't have one? Okay, good. All right. If that's all there is, we will stand and greet each other. Thank you.
I will. between our girls' section and our boys' section this morning. But we have some room in the middle if you're willing to jump in between the two sections. This morning, I want to talk to you guys about something near and dear to my heart. And you see, I got a shoebox. It's Operation Christmas Child. It's about that time. It's getting very close to when we're going to pack these boxes and send them off. So I wanted to talk to you guys about them this morning. And I have some a couple of Bible verses I want to read to you. From Luke 12 this morning. It says, "Do not be afraid, little flock, for your Father has been pleased to give you the kingdom. Sell your possessions and give to the poor. Provide purses for yourselves that will not wear out, a treasure in heaven that will not be exhausted, where no thief comes near and no moth destroys. For where your treasure is, there your heart will be also." He's trying to tell us that the things of the earth don't matter. It doesn't matter if you've got the biggest house in town. It doesn't matter if you've got the nicest clothes in school. It doesn't matter if you've got the biggest bank account of anybody you know. What matters is what we do for Christ, what we do to those other people in the world who don't have as much as we do. If you've got a lot, which all of us are so truly blessed, if you've got a lot, you have to share it with those who don't. That's what Jesus commands, that we help those in need. So, a good way to help, I have another Bible verse. I've tried to tie this in with Operation Christmas Child as much as I could because it means so much to me. In Matthew 25, verse 40, the king will reply, "I tell you the truth, whatever you did for one of the least of these brothers of mine, you did for me." Now, I had the opportunity, I had the great pleasure this weekend of gathering with 10,000 of my closest women friends, many of them here, and we got the privilege of hearing from someone who received one of these shoeboxes. Now, he didn't just get it last year. This gentleman's name was Luis, and he lives in a country called Panama. And he is now 26 years old. But when he was 6 years old, he and his mother and his siblings lived together. And they didn't know where their next meal was coming from. But he wanted to go to school so badly. But where he lived, you couldn't go to school if you didn't have pencils and paper. And they didn't have money for food, so they didn't have money for pencils and paper. And his mother told him, "If you want to go to school, you get on your knees and you pray that God will provide." And you know, the very next week, they were invited to a church service. And when they went, he got a shoebox. And I want you to know, to this day, 26 years old, he's had that box for 20 years. He still has that box as a reminder of God's promise to take care of us. And he received in his box that day, he received some of the same things that we're asking people to put in their boxes. Crayons. We take them for granted. These kids don't have them. If not crayons, maybe colored pencils. Oh, those crayons smell so good. That makes me feel 6 years old again just to smell crayons. That's paper. It doesn't have to be a big trapper keeper or I don't know. What do they even make trapper keepers anymore? I don't know. Notebooks, big three-ring box. No, we don't need those. We need little. We're packing a shoebox. We need little things of paper. Something I know y'all use every day, maybe two or three times a day. Toothbrushes, and they don't have a bathroom to keep theirs in, so they need toothbrush covers. All of those things. Those are things we need. Pencils. We've got plenty of pencils right now, but these are some of the things that we're short on that these kids don't have. And Jesus has commanded us to help those without because we've been given so much. So in the next few weeks, we'll be putting these boxes out. I hope you guys will encourage your parents to pick up one or two of them and pack them yourself so that you'll know the joy of doing that. As a church, we're going to try and send as many as we can, and people have been so generous to give us things to put in these boxes. But like I said, we still need a lot of stuff. But please, when we put the boxes out, take one or two of them home and pack them yourself and let these kids around the world know what God can do for them, okay? All right, let's say our prayers this morning. Our most kind and gracious Heavenly Father, we praise you for all the blessings that you bestow on us, Lord, and just help us to be good and faithful servants to share those with the least of these, Lord, the ones who don't have those things, and share your love with them. We ask you to watch over us and keep us safe today. We ask these things in your precious and holy name. Amen.
The smell of crayons. I hadn't thought about that one in a while. Thank you, Amy. Blessed to be here with y'all. Good to see everybody this morning. If you would, please turn in your Bibles to Isaiah chapter 42, verses 1 through 4. If you're in your pew Bible, that's page 608. This is my servant. I strengthen him. This is my chosen one. I delight in him. I have put my spirit on him. He will bring justice to the nations. He will not cry out or shout or make his voice heard in the streets. He will not break a bruised reed. He will not put out a smoldering wick. He will faithfully bring justice. He will not grow weak or be discouraged until he has established justice on earth. The islands will wait for his instruction. May the Lord bless the reading and hearing of his word. Thank you.
Let us join together to pray. Our Father, your Spirit moved the prophets in the Old Testament to speak forth your word and to deliver the message that would accomplish the purpose for which you sent it. Your Spirit has been active in the life of the church since the day of Pentecost. When you brought us to life, your Spirit has moved, challenged, directed, and helped us all along the way. Still, today we pray, come, Holy Spirit, come. Come as the wind that brings new life, that causes us to be born again, that gives us birth from above, that awakens us to a new world, makes us citizens of a kingdom that we did not create. Come as the fire that cleanses, a cleansing fire that brings purity to the lives of your people, that sanctifies us, sets us apart to you, even in the sinful circumstances in which we live. Come upon us, anoint your people, fill your servants. Come as the word that instructs, that reproves and corrects, that trains us in righteousness, and thoroughly equips us for every good work. Come as the word without which we cannot live. We do not live by bread alone, by every word that proceeds from your mouth. Come revealing the real Jesus and the real us and the real life that he is to us. In his matchless and marvelous name, we dare to pray. And all God's people said,
oh, Let us pray. Father, as we come before you today, let us be mindful of your goodness and your mercy and your love, Father, that you first loved us. And help us today be mindful of the need to share the good news of our Lord Jesus Christ. And we pray, Father, that you'll bless the gift and the giver, and again, that these might be used, that we might share the good news of Christ, in whose name we pray. Amen.
Let's morning prayer. Who thy friends despise, forsake thee, take it to the Lord in prayer. In his arms he'll take and shield thee. Thou wilt find a solace there.
Our worship today has made us think deeply about our sense of need and help us prepare for the celebration of the Lord's Supper today. I want to begin this time of sharing in the Word with a benediction. So if you would, to help you receive the good Word that God has for you, would you just close your eyes for a moment? Now may the God of peace himself sanctify you completely, and may your whole spirit and soul and body be kept blameless at the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. He who calls you is faithful. He will surely do it. Lord, give all of us the spirit of wisdom and of revelation in knowing Jesus, having our hearts enlightened, to know what is the hope to which you have called us, what are the riches of your glorious inheritance in the saints, and what is the immeasurable greatness of your power toward us who believe, according to your working of the might of your strength. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, we pray. And all God's people said. Would you open your Bibles with me today to Matthew chapter 20? Matthew chapter 20, and make your way to verse 25. I want to simply remind you of something that you already know, that you probably already believe, but I want to underscore it, so to speak, and let us in our time together today sort of echo the Word of God that came through our Lord Jesus Christ. Jesus practiced this commitment, instructed his disciples to do the same thing. And then the occasion came for Jesus to speak, so to speak, the final word on this particular subject. Two disciples, or maybe their mother, not sure, you know, both of those are in this in different accounts, but they asked Jesus that one of them would sit on his right hand and the other sit on his left hand in the kingdom. And these guys were looking for positions of honor and authority and power. You know, they were looking to be someone in the kingdom. Obviously, they didn't understand the nature of the kingdom, or they would not have asked Jesus for such a thing, or sent their mother to ask for them. Well, when the other 10 heard that these two disciples had asked for these positions of authority and honor in the kingdom, they became, the scripture says, indignant. And you get the idea that sometimes the disciples squabbled a little bit. They sort of chipped at each other, and they had words to say to each other, and sometimes they took that conversation away from Jesus, and he would just know that it was going on. Well, he happened to know that this squabbling was taking place, that the 10 were indignant with the other two. And so Jesus responded. Jesus responded in Matthew 20, verses 25 through 28. Jesus called them to him and said, "Know that the rulers of the Gentiles lord it over them, and their great ones exercise authority over them. It shall not be so among you, but whoever would be great among you must be your servant. And whoever would be first among you must be your slave, even as the Son of Man came not to be served, but to serve and to give his life a ransom for many." The simple truth that Jesus spoke there is that spiritual people are determined to serve. That is, in their hearts and in their minds and in their way of deciding what they're going to do in their lives, they are determined that whatever it is that takes place, they're going to serve. And that's especially true for spiritual leaders in the life of the congregation, the people that God has called to stand before the people to provide leadership in the life of the church. That's especially true also that we should be determined to serve. An interviewer was asking the chief of a small town volunteer fire department. He wanted to know, how many members do you have? And the chief replied with his own question. He said, are you asking how many people show up for our fish fry or how many fight fires? Good question, good distinction in determining what kind of a member we're talking about. The mayor of Birmingham, Dr. Richard Arrington, was going to speak at the Missionary Baptist Church in Columbus, Mississippi one Sunday afternoon. So the people were coming together for this this occasion, and other churches had been invited to come together, and so the people began gathering and finding a place in the auditorium where they could listen to what the mayor had to say. And Pastor William Wine had instructed the ushers to please direct any visiting ministers to the minister's study. And he wanted to have them together for a few moments and pray over the service and all that. So they came together and they did what ministers do when they get together before the service. They were talking about all kinds of different things and preparing to have prayer. And one of the guys had a question of his own. He said, William, how many members do you have? His response was classic. He said, in the army or on the field? You should catch the distinction, right? How many spiritual leaders do we have? Does the question mean how many have a title to their name? Or how many are actually involved in spiritual leadership? That's a good question. Amen? Matthew uses two words to deal with this subject in a way that's pretty graphic, I think. He uses two words to paint a picture of the kind of servant and the kind of service that Jesus wants us to be. The first word is servant. Diakonia is the word. And I say that only to say that sounds a whole lot like deacon. And in fact, that is the word that is used to describe deacon service. A diakonos is a deacon who provides diakonia, which is deacon kind of service. And so that root of that word comes from waiting on tables. And the truth is that word is applied not only to those who are called to be deacons in the life of the church, but all of the people of God, all of the members of the church are described as performing deacon kind of service. So there aren't any unique qualifications or characteristics of those who serve as deacons. It's incumbent upon all of us to have these kinds of characteristics. So Jesus was saying something not just to the spiritual leaders in a congregation, but to all of us who are involved in this service. And so if you desire it, greatness resides in service. Now, the other word is slave. Doulos is the word that's there. A slave was one who was in a permanent relationship of servitude to another person, and his will would be completely consumed by the will of the other person. He would never have the right to say no. All he has the right to do is say yes. And whatever was determined for him is what he would do. That's the nature of a slave in that day and time. And Jesus is telling his disciples that if you desire to have a first place among your peers in the kingdom of God, then you've got to choose this last place. This has to be your determination. You have to decide that. Now, nobody makes you this kind of a servant. Nobody decides that you're going to be a slave. I can tell you, I had that experience in one of my early churches. There was a lady named Eunice in a church that I served, and Eunice always, nearly every Sunday, managed to interrupt the time that the church staff, I was the associate pastor in that church, interrupt the church staff and the deacons and the choir when we came together for prayer before the service. She usually showed up where we met, and she targeted me every time. You know, I never did anything that she was pleased with. And because I was the administrator in the congregation, she wanted me to do Ryan's job. She wanted me to tend to the landscaping and all that. And so she'd come and tell me things like those bushes are touching the building and that should not be. And you know, and you got to get that fixed. You know, and we're about to go into worship. And you know, she was a little mean spirited. Her husband was the sweetest, gentlest, kindest fellow that you would ever want to meet in all of your life. But she just had a problem with me. And so I went to talk to Myron Madden. Myron Madden, you may remember from years back, was a counselor for the Sunday School Board, and you know, used to read his articles and all that stuff. Really good guy, really good guy. And I said, what's the deal with her? And he said something that I'll never forget. He said, church is the only place that some people will ever be the boss. Now, isn't that right? Isn't that right? That kind of servitude cannot be foisted upon you. Nobody's going to say, you must surrender your will and do the will of the people or do the will of the Lord or do the will of anybody. Nobody is going to do that. That's chosen. That's decided. That is something quite beyond anything anybody else will say to you. Jesus said, if you desire it, then you'll choose this lifestyle. Jesus sealed his instruction with his final word on the subject. He said, the Son of Man did not come to be served. The Son of Man came to be served and to give his life a ransom for many. And the spiritual leader is one who is determined to serve. He wants to live, to give his life, his whole self. That word for life right there, give his life, means self. Everything about him is given to this kind of service for others. He's a person who is not only locked up in his own sense of need and carrying out his own desires in life. He is locked into the needs and concerns of people around him. That's what it takes to be a servant. Bruce Thielman was pastor of the First Presbyterian Church in Pittsburgh. He was talking with his layman, one of his active laymen, a good guy, after a service one day. And the layman kind of, Thielman thought he was confronting him. He said, you preachers talk a lot about giving, but when you get right down to it, it's really just basin theology. That caught Thielman by surprise. He said, what's basin theology? I have no idea what you're talking about. And so the layman said, remember, Pilate threw away his opportunity to acquit Jesus. And in order to demonstrate that, he called for a basin to be given to him, and he washed his hands, and he said, I don't have any part in this anymore. He distanced himself from the responsibility that was his, from the opportunity that was his. He just washed his hands of the whole thing. The layman continued, but remember the night before, Jesus also took a basin in his hands, and he filled it with water, and he went from disciple to disciple, and he washed their feet to demonstrate the fullness of his love for them, to love them to the complete end of all that he was doing. He used the basin. And so he said, that's what basin theology is. And the question is, which basin do you use? Do you use the one to wash your hands of all responsibility, or do you use the basin with which you will serve other people? That's the real question. An eight-year-old boy went to a concert, piano concert, that was going to be delivered by Ignacy Paderewski. And amazingly, the mother took her eight-year-old son because he had started taking piano lessons, and she wanted him to witness the great, you know, Paderewski playing on the stage. And so she had a seat down toward the front and all that. And some friends came in, and she began talking with them, and she took her attention away from the little eight-year-old boy, and nobody seemed to notice that he wandered up on the stage, and he sat down at the Steinway grand piano that was sitting on the stage that the master was about to play, and then he started tinkling on the piano. He had learned Twinkle, Twinkle, Little Star, and he was playing Twinkle, Twinkle, Little Star, unknown to the little boy. Paderewski walked up behind him. The audience kind of gasped. And Paderewski leaned over and whispered in the little boy's ear. He said, "Keep playing, don't stop." And then with his left hand, he started adding some bass notes. And he wrapped his right hand around the little boy and started playing in a higher range. He started playing obbligato parts. And the two of them played Twinkle, Twinkle, Little Star, and it mesmerized an audience. Think of your Heavenly Father wrapping his arms around you when you make the decision, when you make the commitment, when you reach the determination that your life is for serving. And you begin your Twinkle, Twinkle, Little Star kind of service. And your Heavenly Father joins in and mesmerizes the people that you love and serve and giving. That's what this day's about. Spiritual leaders are determined to serve. Let me add one last thought. By the very power that God invests in them. Let's think about that as we come together to the Lord's table. The Lord's table at First Baptist Church is for believers. The Lord's table is not just for church members. The Lord's table is for us to remember that Jesus died on a cross for our sins, to remember and anticipate that he is returning to us at the end of the age. It's a way for us to physically affirm our faith in the one who loved us and gave himself for us. And so it's a very, very important thing. We will serve the elements and then take each element at the same time together. And you're welcome, if you're a believer in Christ, to participate with us. I ask that as you think about this day, this service, this moment in your life, I ask you to think about making a definite, personal commitment to become a servant of the Lord in the living of your daily life. And if by chance you are nominated to serve as deacon and later in the month elected as deacon, I hope that decision and that choice, that commitment that you make, will be fulfilled in the ministry that God will give to you. Let's pray. Our Father, we thank you for your goodness and grace, for your love and your mercy. We thank you for power that infuses our lives and enables us to do what we could not do on our own, even giving us the will to work for your good pleasure. So we pray, Father, now as we come to this table, give us clear insight and help us come to the decision to become servants of all in the spirit in which Jesus spoke those words. In his name we pray. Amen. Close my eyes and hold my heart. Cover me and make me something. Change the something normal into something.